Good morning. Good to have you here on a beautiful, beautiful day to worship. And we want to be singing about our great God. So if you would stand as we sing an opening song, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not, as Thou hast been now forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord unto me.
Some announcements.
Well, good morning. It's good to see you all here this morning, and good to be here in worship with you. Hopefully you received a connection card as you came in this morning, and we'd love to have you fill that out. Let us know that you are here. Let us know how we can be praying for you and connect with you. Whatever's going on in your life, we'd love to hear about it. If you have stories about things that God is doing and things you want to share, we'd love to hear about it. So note on there that you would like to contact or that you have a prayer request, and we'd love to get in touch with you. If you're new with us, there's also a QR code on that card that you can scan, and you can fill out just a little bit of information and let us know that you're here this morning. So tonight is House of Prayer back here at 6 p.m. here in the Worship Center, and we're excited to invite you to come and join together for a time of just worship and prayer from hearing from Holy Spirit together. It's just a powerful time of sharing together, and so we invite you to that. And then there's going to be another opportunity for worship later on this week, on Friday evening at 7 p.m. There's going to be an intimate night of worship that's going to be here in the Worship Center. And so we would invite you to come and just celebrate the goodness of who God is in worship together. There's going to be childcare for that event as well, which will be great. And so you can bring your younger kiddos as well and come and enjoy an evening of worship together. And then we want to just give you an update. This past weekend was the Kansas Mennonite Relief Sale, as many of you know, and many of you, I'm sure, attended and were a part of. We just want to say a big thank you. Thank you for volunteering and for being a part of it, for being generous with your time and your resources to support such a big initiative. We have so many people from our Journey family that take a big leadership role, and we're just really grateful to see the ways that God works and moves. The sale raised over $500,000 in 2 days. So, yeah. That's an incredible amount of money, incredible amount of generosity that's then able to be shared with people who are in need all over the world, globally, who are struggling from effects of war, natural disaster, displacement for various reasons. That money goes straight there, and so that's awesome to see. So thank you for being generous, for supporting them, for being a part of that ministry. So with that, I would invite you to stand back up and say hello to a few people around you this morning and welcome them here, and we'll continue in worship.
It sounds great out there. It's like a holy roar. And just want to, again, invite you to a morning where we worship our God. We've been being taught about the greatness of God and how He is greater than all, greater than everything that could hinder us in our lives. And these songs today want to reflect that great God. So we're going to sing about that now.
Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God and man. You are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name.
every tongue confess to the glory of God. You are Lord. We love you, Lord. You are a great God. Amen.
Thank you.
this time, you can have a seat. The ushers come forward. We're going to take an offering of worship, of praise, of giving our best to our great God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for all you've given us. Thank you that you are a great God. And we give because you have given to us, generous, more than we deserve. We say thank you. We love you, Lord. We give in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. It is good to see you all here this morning and to celebrate Jesus together with you. To those who are watching online, thank you for joining alongside of us, and I would encourage you to click on that link below so you can connect with us and let us know that you're connected with us, but also if there's anything we can pray with you about, we can join together with you. So today what I want to start off with is just praying together with those in our community. Well, first off, I want to start off by just saying, I now know how to make ham gravy. JJ and I did decide that next year we're going to bring in a couple of big cans of jalapenos and try to mix up a few extra batches just to see what people think, you know, get some surprised looks out there, you know. But thank you again to all of those who participated with the KMRS sale, and just being able to, in one little way, participate in what God is doing and reaching out to those around the world that are in need. There's a couple of verses in Scripture, and this is where I want to start this morning. And in Genesis chapter 8, God is after the flood, and God is speaking to Noah, and he's making this commitment with Noah. He says, in chapter 8, verse 22, he says, "As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease." As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. And in Deuteronomy chapter 11, as the children of Israel are getting ready to enter into the promised land, in verse 13 says, "If you faithfully obey the commands I'm giving you today to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, I will send rain on your land in its season, both autumn and spring rain, so that you may gather in your grain, new wine, and olive oil. I will provide grass in the fields for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied." So we are in a time where I just thought we would start this morning and just pray and just ask the Lord to send rain upon our land, because how many of you know a farmer or you are a farmer? And it's been a rough 3 years. And so let's just pray and just say, "Lord, would you just bless our land? Would you open up the heavens over the land in Reno County, Kansas, and the surrounding areas, Kansas as a whole, so that your rain would come down and that the ground would receive the moisture that it needs so that the harvest can come forth." So, Lord, we do come to you to get day, and we do thank you that you are the Lord of the harvest, and you are the Lord of the rain, and you are the Lord of the skies, and you are the Lord who promised that seed time and harvest would never end as long as the earth endures. And you also said to pray and to ask for rain. And so, Lord, we do ask you for rain. And on behalf of our brothers and sisters who are in the farming community and how that affects all of us, Lord God, we just pray for mercy. Let the heavens bring forth rain upon this land, that the seed may do what it's supposed to do, germinate properly and grow properly, and that the harvest would come. We honor you and we bless you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. One other quick announcement. I would encourage you throughout this week, just pray and say, Lord, thank you for sending rain. Thank you for sending rain. So we're going through the book of Hebrews, and it's a really, like we mentioned as we started this series, that if we really wanted to go through the book of Hebrews, we'd have to take about 3 years. We thought that might be a little bit long for a series, so we're kind of honing it down and focusing on how Jesus is greater. This is an incredible resource if you're interested. This is Hebrews for Everyone, Dr. N.T. Wright, who's one of my favorite theologians that just understands how God came to establish kingdom in this world, in us and through us. And it includes a study guide. This is someone who reads and writes ancient Greek and understands the culture and the context of in so many beautiful ways. So he includes his own translation, but then a commentary. And in the back, there's a study guide. So if you really want to dig your teeth into Hebrews and go deeper, I would encourage this. You can come and ask me afterwards again, and I would be happy to show you. So we're going to start today in John chapter 1 as we continue this series that Jesus is greater. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at John chapter 1. We're going to reference it. What is John saying to us here? And then we're going to kind of go in a big circle through Hebrews and right back up in John. So there's a lot. That's a big circle. So John chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we gazed upon his glory, the glory like that of the Father's only Son, full of yes, it is out of his fullness that we have all received grace indeed on top of grace. The law, you see, was given through Moses. Grace and truth came, Jesus, the Messiah." And so in this one section of scripture here, John chapter 1, 14, and I skip verse 15 and 15, basically the John the Baptist points right back to Jesus, says, hey, pay attention to what's there. So in this one passage, we see grace and truth. Grace indeed upon top of grace. Grace and truth came through Jesus. And John obviously wants us to pay attention. He repeats it over and over. Pay attention, pay attention, pay attention. We don't have time today, but I would encourage you to read Psalm 85. John is definitely inspired by what Psalm 85 tells us in a very messianic way. But in what John is saying to us is, in Jesus, grace and truth have come together. In Jesus, grace and truth have come together. And when we talk about grace and truth, I think sometimes they can kind of be abstract biblical terms. But the point of John's gospel is that grace and truth are not this nebulous try to figure out exactly what they mean thing. Grace and truth became flesh. And grace and truth walked among us. And when we see grace and truth, and we're like, oh, look, there it is. It's walking in the world around us. In other words, grace and truth is not this abstract theological term that we have to try to understand what it means. Grace and truth walks where we walk. And how many of you would agree that we desperately need grace and truth walking around in the world today? We desperately need grace and truth walking in the world today. In summary, and this really isn't the message, it's the intro. But in summary, what the world has tried to do for hundreds of years, really since the Enlightenment, is try to have truth without grace. Grace, God's unmerited favor, merited favor that he lavishes upon us and his empowerment to do what he calls us to do, grace. The world has tried to find and discover truth apart from grace. And what has happened is it leads to arrogance, and it leads to a disregard for the welfare of others. And it leads to, eventually takes us down the road, and we end up in suspicion and manipulation. On the other hand, the church, we've been in danger many times of trying to offer grace but not truth. Where we just say, well, you know what, we're just going to love you just the way you are. And we do love you just the way you are, but we're also called to call you to who God created you to be. We love you just the way you are, and I hope you love me just the way I am, even if I put jalapenos in your precious ham gravy. You love me just right, but yet we call each other to truth, because if we have grace and no truth, we end up with moral laxity and a lack of genuine integrity. grace and truth. It is only when grace and truth come together that we can truly become those who are not only praying, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, but we can also then become those who are actively participating with Jesus as he calls us to become the answer to the very prayer we are praying. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done through me, Jesus, and in the world around us. And it's not just this large global picture of the world and the church as a whole, but as we're going to be jumping into Hebrews today and as we begin to see how Jesus is greater today, we're going to realize that that starts right here. It starts right here, and it starts right here. And then it just continues to grow as we step into covenant partnership with each other and encourage each other. Today, as we continue this series that Jesus is greater, today we're going to be challenging ourselves to live in response to Jesus is greater. See, we've been talking about how Jesus is greater. He's greater than sin, shame, condemnation, the spiritual forces in the heavenly realms, whether angelic or demonic. He is greater than death. We've seen that Jesus is greater, and we're going to see today the call then is to respond and to live into the greater that he has called us into. The big idea we're going to be looking at today is this. What Jesus has done to bring us to himself is greater than anything we could do in our own strength. Therefore, we have to trust him, encourage and challenge each other, and let his words transform us. As we boldly turn to him, he empowers us with everything we need to follow him well. That's kind of like big ideas, not the big idea. He empowers us with everything that we need to follow him well. And what we're going to be looking at is kind of three main areas that the law was given as humanity tried to become perfect enough to walk with God. Jesus is greater than the law because in him, God is the one who has made us holy. We're going to see that sin and unbelief are deceitful and destructive, and they result in our hearts being hardened to the fullness of the life God desires to birth in us. God has placed covenant partners around us to encourage us and challenge us. And then finally, that the word that God has spoken and the word he speaks to us through Jesus is powerful and will transform us. It is his grace and power that enables us to live the life he calls us to live. So Lord, we just come to you today, and Lord, we bring to you who we are and what we have. And Lord, I just pray that as your Holy Spirit is present here today, Holy Spirit, come and teach us what you desire to teach us. Point us to Jesus. Reveal what the Father's heart for us as we study the scripture and as we dive into what you have for us. I pray that each one here today would that their hearts would be touched by your spirit, Lord God, and that the word that is planted would produce a harvest in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to start in Hebrews chapter 3. As I mentioned last week, as we ran through Hebrews 1 and 2, we obviously don't have time to go through every single chapter, find a good study guide, read through it, study it. We're going to be going through chapters 3 and 4, not the whole chapters. I encourage you, this is the week, maybe ask the Holy Spirit if you're supposed to take a time every day just to begin to read through chapters 3 and 4 and find yourself. What is he teaching you? We're going to be looking at a few different passages today. So in chapter 3, verse 1, Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. Verse 2, he was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was faithful in all God's house. Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses, just as the builder of the house has greater honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything. Moses was faithful as a servant in all God's house, bearing witness to what would be spoken by God in the future, but Christ is faithful as the son over God's house, and we are his house, if we indeed hold firmly to our confidence and the hope in which we glory. This passage starts off by saying, therefore, holy brothers and sisters, fix your thoughts on Jesus. That reminds me, last week we saw chapter 2 starts off by saying, hey, we must pay careful attention. We must. We don't have an option. We need to pay careful attention to what he has spoken. Hebrews chapter 1 starts off the entire book by saying that God has spoken to us in Jesus, in the language of Son. And so we must pay attention to what he has spoken. And then as a result, it says in verse chapter 3, verse 1, fix your thoughts on Jesus. Fix your thoughts. The But it actually starts off by saying this: therefore, holy brothers and sisters, therefore. Remember, whenever we see the word therefore, what are we supposed to do? What is it there for? Find out, what is it there for? And as we've gone through chapters 1 and we've gone through chapter 2, what we've seen is that God has spoken to us in Jesus, that Jesus is greater than sin, he is greater than shame, he is greater than condemnation, he is greater than anything that would try to trap us and hold us back, he is greater than temptation, he is greater. Tell the person next to you, Jesus is greater. And you can fill in the blank. And so because Jesus is greater, what the writer of Hebrews, or the Holy Spirit says, so therefore, because Jesus is greater, and with that in mind, because you are paying attention, fix your thoughts. The word that's translated fix means to consider attentively. Exercise your mind to perceive or discover. In other words, as I come across a situation in my life, I exercise my mind to perceive, Jesus, where are you and what are you doing? As I encounter daily life, as I'm checking out at Dylan's and I feel like, oh, I need to say something to the, I need to encourage the person. I don't want to talk to the person behind me. I perceive, Jesus, what are you saying in the situation? I fix my thoughts upon Jesus. Why? Because he is greater. Therefore, I fix my thoughts upon him. I look to him. Why? And it goes on to say that because we acknowledge him as our apostle and our high priest, because he is the one who both started this work and he's the one who stands ready to make sure it takes place. He started his work in us. He is the one who will continue to pay attention to make sure it takes place. In other words, he's the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. He's the author, the one who writes the story of our faith, and the consumer of our faith, the one who fulfills the story of our faith. We pay attention, Jesus. Fix your thoughts upon Jesus. And what's interesting is there's a contrast in this passage between Moses and Jesus, and Jesus is shown to be greater than Moses. And for us, we're like, oh yeah, obviously, duh. But in the world of the Hebrew believer in the early church, we have to understand Moses was the epitome, the embodiment of everything that we strive to achieve in life. Everything. Moses is the one who tells us, if you will do this, you can walk with God, and then gives us 500 plus commandments. And then basically we find ourselves saying, oof. Well, I'm good at 490 of them, those last 10. So Moses is like considered the perfection. But what happens is the law comes, and remember where we started, the law came through Moses, but grace and truth comes through Jesus Christ. The law is good because the law means that we find out, oh, I'm a hot mess. Tell the person next to you, the law will tell you you're a mess. See, some of you are like, they don't need the law to tell them that. The law brings us to a place where we are not ignorant. If I will just do this, I can achieve holiness. Yet, the author of Hebrews is like, we've kind of figured out that we can't quite be good enough. But that's why Jesus is greater than Moses, because in Jesus, he is the one who calls us. And this is incredible. It says we share a heavenly calling because Jesus is both the one who calls us to be holy, but also makes us holy. And so Jesus is greater than Moses, and he's greater. In other words, what the writer of Hebrews is saying is Jesus is greater than the greatest. No matter what you consider great, or the person, or the situation, or the paradigm of thoughts and ideas that you consider to be the greatest that will allow you to achieve what you desire to achieve, Jesus is greater. Jesus is greater. He brought us into the full relationship that God always desired with us. And not because we finally did what was necessary, but because of his great mercy. He is so much greater than anything that could keep us, that held us, everything that held us back from feeling like we could approach God. And because Jesus is greater, therefore, we share a heavenly calling. Tell the person next to you, you share a heavenly calling with me. We share a heavenly calling. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters, look at that. Tell the person next to you, hello, holy brother. Hello, holy sister. It says, therefore, holy brothers and sisters, we share a heavenly calling. The word that's translated, share in the heavenly calling, basically what it means is, it could be translated, we are participants in the invitation to live in the realm above. Participants in the invitation to live in the realm above, to live in what is above. Fix your minds on things above and not on things on this world. We are, in other words, you could say we are partners in his identity, in who he is. It is vital. Therefore, fix your thoughts on Jesus. Why? Because he is greater. He is greater than what tells me I cannot approach God. He is greater than what I try to do to make myself feel like, okay, I had a good day. Jesus is greater. So we fix our thoughts upon him so that we can live as brothers and sisters, as those who bear the family name and carry the family resemblance. And I've shared this before, but one of the things that just makes me chuckle is when you're holding a newborn baby or you see a parent with their children, and I so often hear the comment like, oh, he looks just like his mom. Oh, he looks just like his dad. And what makes me chuckle is because it's like, that's the point, right? If the child does not look like the parents, we need to have a conversation. When Jesus says, you are my brothers and sisters, chapter 2 says he's not ashamed to call us his brothers. We share in this heavenly identity. We are called to live in grace and truth. Fix our thoughts on Jesus, and it will keep our hearts right before God. Why do we fix our thoughts on Jesus? Because has anybody besides me ever discovered it's easy to get distracted? So we have to intentionally fix our thoughts on Jesus. And as we continue, we find out why. Because there's a warning that continues here. Verse 8, Hebrews chapter 3, verse 8. Do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion during the time of the testing in the wilderness. Verse 12. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today. I love that phrase. When's today? When we are living in tomorrow, what's it going to be? Today. And when in 3 weeks, when we are living on whatever date that is, what will that day be? Today. And I love how it says, we encourage each other daily, and just in case you didn't figure it out, encourage each other today. We encourage each other today so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. So Hebrews continues on. It says, fix your thoughts upon Jesus. Jesus is greater than Moses. And the writer of Hebrews takes us back to this incredible historical event that took place where the children of Israel, imagine the children of Israel in slavery, in bondage, and their sons being slaughtered, and it was just an evil place as they were captive by Egypt. And God shows up in an incredible way, and you read through the plagues, and you read through the deliverance, and you're just like, wow, these people experienced firsthand God's incredible power. They experienced the power to turn the longest river in the world. Is it the longest? Yeah, into blood. I gotta go back to geography real quick. They saw the power of God that smote the crops of. I mean, they saw God protect where they lived while everything around them was being destroyed. They saw God's power as he divided a sea so they could walk through it on dry. They saw God's power in an incredible way. And 2 minutes later, they're like, "Well, I'm hungry. Why'd you bring us here to die? It was better to be a slave." There's an incredible truth that the author of Hebrews is reminding us of. See, the same people that saw God descend on the mountain and saw the mountain tremble, they saw Moses come down from the mountain, his face glowing so brightly with the glory of God that he had to cover his face. They saw God do such incredible things. There was something that they held on to in their heart that said, yeah, but. And they took everything that they saw God do and they interpreted it based upon their present circumstances and their present situations. And they said, well, did you bring us out here to die? As if God would do everything that he did in order just to bring them. But their present circumstances, their present feeling, their present desires, the hunger or the thirst or whatever they were feeling in that moment caused them to say, well, it was better back then. They were willing to make exceptions for sin or hold on to unbelief, and it destroyed them. Scripture says their hearts were hardened. And the sinful heart and the unbelieving heart meant that they then turned away from the very one who had delivered them. The children of Israel lived and experienced the incredible life-freeing power of God as they were delivered from Egypt, yet they quickly came to doubt the very one who had freed them. What are some ways that we tend to forget what God has done? Why is it hard to remember the faithfulness of God yesterday when we are encountering hardship today? I mean, that's where they were. See, we have to be careful. We have to pay careful attention to what he has said so we don't drift away. See, it's easy for us to say, God, you are so good, I would never not trust you. I would never doubt you. But there's a reason the author of Hebrews says, hey, pay careful attention. Hey, fix your thoughts on Jesus. Because otherwise we fall into the trap of doubting that Jesus is greater than fill in the blank. See, in the midst of what we encounter daily, we have to keep our thoughts on Jesus and our trust in him. And what's interesting is the author of Hebrews calls it a sinful, unbelieving heart. Sinful, unbelieving heart. But then he goes on and says, and we have to encourage each other so we don't fall into the trap of sin's deceitfulness. Imagine if I come here right now and I bring you a big knife, a very sharp knife. And I tell you, you know what? I want to prove how good God is, so I want you to take this knife and chop off one finger. You have 10, 9 still good. You would probably look at me like, you are crazy. You cannot trick me into cutting off a finger. Why? Because in order for, C.S. Lewis says it like this, nothing can deceive unless it bears a plausible resemblance to reality. Nothing can deceive. And so sin is deceitful because it comes to us and says, well, if you just do this, it will be better. You'll be happier. You'll be at peace. You won't have to deal. And we can go on and on down the list of things. But Ed Stephen Olford says, the deadliest sins do not leap upon us, they creep upon us. The deadliest sins do not leap upon us, they creep upon us. And there's this old saying that says, sin will take you further than you ever wanted to stray. It will cost you more than you ever dreamed you would pay. And it will keep you longer than you ever thought you would stay. Thomas Brooks says, sin is of a very deceitful and bewitching nature. It will kiss the soul and look enticing to the soul and yet betray the soul forever. It's deceitful. But if we go back to the beginning of that same verse, chapter 3, verse 13, it says, therefore, encourage one another daily. Encourage one another daily. Hey, while it's still today, let me remind you what Jesus has done. Remind you of who he is. Remind you of where he desires. Why? So that we won't fall into the trap of that slowly drifting away. I am helping you keep your eyes fixed upon Jesus, your thoughts fixed upon Jesus. The word that's translated therefore or encourage is parakaleo, which means literally to call alongside someone, to call someone to oneself, to call for, to summon. And the beautiful image of parakaleo is this: it's like two parents that are teaching they're going out roller skating with their child. And has anybody ever gone roller skating with a 3, 4, or 5-year-old. It's fun. It's amusing. It's also a chore. Because obviously you care for the child, so you don't want them to hurt themselves, but it is kind of funny. So what you do is you come alongside and you find yourself in that place where sometimes you are carrying them, other times you're just there so they can have their balance, but you are alongside them so that they can achieve what they you're desiring to achieve. One of the Greek historians used the word parakaleo to describe a Greek regiment that had lost heart and was utterly dejected. So the general sent a leader to talk to this regiment with such purpose that courage was reborn and the body of dispirited men again became fit for heroic action. Encourage. And so this idea of encourage doesn't mean just like, you can do it. You got it. What it means is I come alongside you and I not only say, hey, remember what Jesus has done. I also say, hey, you're bigger than that because of who's in you. God made you for better than that. And I challenge you and I encourage you. Why? So that you or you challenge me and you encourage me so that we don't drift away and lose our focus. Encourage one another daily as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We're called to encourage. We're called to be those who encourage and challenge each other, but who also allow others to encourage and challenge us. Has anybody ever been in that spot besides me where it's like, I know you're here to encourage me and I don't want to hear it right now? See, so it's not just enough that I'm willing to come and encourage you. I also have to walk in the humility and the grace to say, I will let you come and encourage me too. Why? Because I realize that even though my soul doesn't want to hear it right now, I don't want to hear about how Jesus is greater right now because I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. I don't want to hear about how he delivered me from Egypt. I'm thirsty. But yet I have to be willing to say, but come, I will allow you to encourage me. So how do we encourage one another? As covenant partners that remind each other who Jesus is and challenge each other to live the lives we are called to live, to expose the sin for what it is, and to provoke the faith that we need in our hearts, how do we encourage one another? And I think in chapter 4, the author of Hebrews, the Holy Spirit leads us right into the greatest way we can challenge and encourage each other. We're going to start in verse 12. It says, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. See, here's the thing. His word will cut deep if we let it. Cut deep in a good sense. See, the truth in the life that the living word lived, the way, the truth, and the life. The truth that are the words that the living word spoke and that are recorded for us right here. Or the truth that the Holy Spirit of Jesus inspired men to write down is truth that will cause our lives to spring up into strength and purpose. How? It cuts straight to the point. It speaks to us and it challenges us. It says, this is who you are called to be, therefore don't do that. This is what you can do, therefore don't sell yourself short. Jesus himself said in John chapter 6, verse 63, he said, it is the spirit who gives life, the flesh profits nothing, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and are life. So, as we come alongside each other and we lift each other up to encourage each other, here's the question, are we encouraging with our own words and our own thoughts? Like, well, what I think, I feel, oops, you did it again. What's going on? Are we coming with our own words and our own thoughts? Or are we encouraging and challenging each other with what Jesus says to us? See, if I am called and you are called to fix our thoughts on Jesus, and yet I find myself in a weak place and I need you to encourage me, the call then is to help me to once again fix my thoughts upon Jesus. Saying things like, I know that you feel this way and the pain is real, but Jesus has promised that his grace is sufficient for us. Scripture. I know you don't have any more strength, but that is why I'm here right now with you, and I don't even know what to say, but I will groan in prayer together with you. And the promise is that God's Holy Spirit will also groan with us and pray with us. So in this place where I come to help you fix your eyes on Jesus, what I do is I point you to Jesus. And the word comes and it cuts through the emotions of the soul and it points out the life and the spirit and it reveals what God is doing within us. The most profound way to call each other to live the greater life of Jesus is by sharing his word with each other. D.L. Moody said this. He said, "The scriptures were not given to increase our knowledge, but to change our lives." The scriptures were not given so we can say, "Oh, I remember that that happened." But they're given to change and transform our lives. See, his word, the living word, the words that Jesus spoke, the words that the Holy Spirit spoke through men inspired by God and written down for us, the word doesn't play games. It swiftly reveals what is going on inside of our hearts, whether we like it or not. And the beautiful part is that while his word cuts deep, it brings healing. While it destroys darkness, it births life. And while it attacks unbelief, it produces faith. His word not only reveals who we were always meant to be, but it empowers us to live that life. Are we willing then to allow and to others to encourage and challenge us to be those who live in the greater life that Jesus has called us to live? I'm going to close with this text. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16, and it says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who ascended into heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." We can't live this life. We can't encourage each other to live the life that God has called us to live on our own strength, but that's okay. Because we can boldly receive the grace we need, the strength we need from Jesus, because he is greater. He is greater. I love that phrase. It says, we boldly come before the throne of grace. We approach God's throne with confidence, not hoping that God will take time to fit us into his schedule. We come to him boldly and say, "Jesus, this is where I am. This is what I need." And it says that we receive the grace and the mercy that we need. We come to the one who knows us better than ourselves. We sit and we listen to what he would say to us. We read through scripture and allow him to correct us. We encourage one another and recognize that he is speaking through our brothers and sisters so that we won't be hardened and so we can firmly hold on to the faith that he has given to us. John chapter 1, verse 14. "The word became flesh and lived among us. We gazed upon his glory, the glory of that, like that of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in a heavenly calling, fix your thoughts upon Jesus." John said, we gaze upon his glory. The writer of Hebrews says, fix your thoughts upon Jesus. We gaze upon your glory. See, one of the greatest truths about spirituality is you will become like that which you worship. That which most holds your attention and focus. And what the Apostle John says is, we gazed upon his glory. We beheld his glory. So that the marriage of grace and truth that we see and know in Christ can also be born in us. Grace and truth. Grace and truth. The grace and the truth that we saw walking the streets with Jesus is the grace and the truth that we can see as we walk the streets together in a world that so desperately needs grace and truth, so that we can be a people in a community in whom God's grace generates and sustains human integrity, wholeness, holiness of character. We can become the people in and through whom God's grace overflows to the world around us. Fix your thoughts on Jesus, the apostle and the priest, the one in whom we discover grace and truth. And I'm going to close with the third verse after I said that there was one more. Psalms chapter 85, and I'm going to combine Psalms chapter 85, verses 10 and 11 with John 1, 16. It says, Psalms 85 says, "Grace and truth have met together. Justice and peace have kissed each other. Truth springs up from the earth as justice looks down from the heaven. And from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth through Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we just come to you today and we thank you that you call us to live the life that is greater in you, Jesus. But you don't just call us to be holy. You are also the one who makes us holy. But you're also the one who then places us within community where those covenant partners, those who are stubbornly committed to the relationship one with another, those covenant partners around us can challenge us and encourage us. And we can challenge and encourage and hold those up who are weak and help each other to fix our thoughts on Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would provide a warning within our spirits that the deceitfulness of sin would be exposed for what it is, and that we can encourage each other to walk in the truth that you call us to walk to, but full of grace and full of mercy, because that's what we receive from your throne. So we honor you and we love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You know, it's where our hearts are at that's important. That's what our worship is about. That's what Jesus looks to us every day, is about our hearts. So this song is just a response that's offering our hearts to Jesus. So if you can and want to, stand and sing with us this prayer of commitment.
Thank you.
encourage you as you go out this week. Let that be your prayer. Jesus, here I am. Speak what is true. But let the second part of that prayer be, and Lord, however it comes, I'm willing to listen. Whether I like it or not, I'm willing to listen. Speak what is true. Thank you so much for being here today. Have a great week. Keep your thoughts fixed upon Jesus. Hold fast to what he has spoken to us. Encourage one another. Find someone. You know what? Call somebody this week and just encourage them, saying, I've been praying for you. Pray for them first. I've been praying for you, and I want to encourage you that Jesus has great things for you. God bless you all. Have a great day.
Person I was before I encountered
not.